just gotta wonder what my daddy would have done. He'd seen the way they turned this dream around. I gotta go by what he told me. Try to tell the truth and stand your ground. Don't let the bastards get you down.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Speaking Freely, a weekly conversation about free speech in America. I'm Ken Paulson. Our guest today is a man who has used that freedom in remarkable ways, the highly respected songwriter, singer, and actor, Kris Kristofferson. Great to have you here.
Thanks, Ken.
You do not pull your punches, do you? You aren't going to warm this audience up with, like, me and Bobby McGee. You're going to go right for it, one of your toughest songs.
You might as well know when to leave.
The people who are still watching are going to be very much into the show, I'm sure.
I hope so.
That has been the hallmark of your music, and you talk about telling the truth. You've made a practice throughout your career of writing songs that reflected what you really believed. Has there been an exception to that?
I think I figured when I came here, that's what I came here to do. And of course, John Cash was an inspiration and a good example for me for that.
When you say came here, I should tell our viewers that we are in Nashville.
Yes.
A city that is not your home, but began your career.
Well, it saved my life, is what it did.
And we also need to share the good news that there's a brand new CD out called Broken Freedom Song on Old Boy Records, a live recording from San Francisco, which I guess was initially done in conjunction with a Bread and Roses benefit.
Yes, there was Alan Abraham was taping the show, so I could give a song off it to. Mimi Frenia and Joan Baez's organization for the shut-ins, prisoners, and hospital people.
Let's talk about those beginnings in Nashville, because what an interesting choice you made. I mean, it's often been talked about, you were a Rhodes Scholar, you had an opportunity to teach at West Point. Your future was very bright in one direction, and you took the ultimate risk, coming to Nashville, becoming a songwriter, and emptying ashtrays in a recording studio. That had to be horrifying to your family.
You picked the right word, Ken. No, it was for a few years there, about four, it did look pretty stupid. Hmm. But I've always felt like it was the best thing, best move I ever made, and just about in the nick of time.
Hmm. What drove you? I mean, how did you know that this was something you could do so well for the rest of your life?
Well, I didn't know I could do anything. I didn't know I'd be a success at it, but I came here on leave when I was still in the Army, and Mary John Wilkin was a cousin of my platoon leader in Germany, and he had sent her a tape of mine. She said, stop by, you know, if he's ever in the area. She didn't say anything about the songs, but it was enough of an encouragement to come here. And in the 2 weeks I spent here, I just fell in love with it, with the whole way of life, with the whole music family.
And we had actually Cowboy Jack Clement was on the show.
Well, he was one of the first guys I met here.
I mean, you fell immediately into the community.
Yeah.
And you met Johnny Cash very early on.
Yeah.
And
Cowboy helped that out, too.
And there are people who are in this town now who have never run into people who can help their career, but there were mm-hmm. people who actually were in a position to hear your music, and if they weren't willing to, you're going to find other ways. There is this great story, and I don't know if it's true or not, but you can set the record straight, about you in a helicopter and Johnny Cash.
Well, I have to go back before that. I'd known John about a year and a half before I ever did anything that audacious. But I was his janitor over at Columbia Record Studios for about a year and a half. And then I got in the National Guard for about a month. And during that time, I figured that would... I had pitched him every song I ever wrote. And he hadn't caught any of them. But he had always encouraged me and carried my lyrics around in his pocket, you know. And I figured I would impress him one way or another if I flew into there with that helicopter, and I did.
Who was
lucky
there?
I didn't crash it in the house, because they were pretty old helicopters.
Who was the first one out the door, June or Johnny?
You know, I can't remember. I can't remember. They both got versions of it that kind of differ from mine, but I owe so much to them. I believe whatever they say.
I think there's a quote from you that said you pitched every song you could to Johnny Cash because you were convinced he wasn't going to live very long, that he was on pills. He was a really skinny gentleman.
Well, back in those days, it didn't look like he was going to be around much more, and Hank Williams only made it to 29.
Let me embarrass you with an early record called Vietnam Blues. Maybe you're not embarrassed by it.
I'm not embarrassed about it.
It's completely different from your later politics, and it was of the time. And those people.
Well, I was still in the Army when I wrote that.
Right. And it's a song. It's a very honest song as well. And it was a song, I guess, Dave Dudley recorded.
Dave Dudley cut it. Before that, Jack Sanders did it, and it made a friend, Harlan Howard, and. Ralph Emery, which both of them were good friends.
For those who haven't heard it, it's a song about a gentleman who's walking on the street and he sees protesters and they're actually handing around a petition asking to send condolences, I guess, to Ho Chi Minh, I guess.
It was a talking blues.
Yeah, and then in the end you discover that the person who's singing is actually a soldier and he's headed off to Vietnam. It's a very powerful record. I just read that you had mixed feelings about the song later.
Well, only because my own feelings about Vietnam turned 180 degrees. But I still felt at the time, you know, that all my friends were over there. And it wasn't their fault that they were over there. But I come to believe that it was a tremendous mistake for our government to be over there. And that the things that we were doing were inhuman.
Can I put you on the spot and ask you to do Vietnam Blues?
I'll give it a try.